So, yes. Last we left off, we finally reached Homestead. It's not like I said that off here during the break or on the BRB screen and figured, hang on, I could use that as an opener while in the game. We've brought Ulgrim's motley mob of refugees over here, and yeah, hopefully they're doing okay. We'll have to find them out, hunt them down, and then speak with Ulgrim again. But anyway, there's a person here, Isaiah Redden, that we can speak with. Oh, another thing that happened during the break is I noticed that the black cat that likes to shout at me at 10 p.m. at night until I open the window and look down at him and ask him what's going on, I just noticed that that cat was sitting on my shed roof. I would say sunning himself, but it's overcast today, so don't know what he's doing up there. Anyway, yeah, just cat things. Yeah, exactly. Seems our roads cross again. Glad to see you've survived the wilderness. I appreciate you letting me tell my side of the story back in the Arcovian foothills. Ah, yes, this was the chap that we were sent to kill, but turned out things weren't as they seemed. Most people wouldn't bother getting all the details straight. Glad you made it through. Say, I've gathered up quite a few interesting things while travelling out there. I suppose you'd be interested in buying something. Only best deals for a friend. Let's take a look then. So, we've gained access to a vendor here. And Josephine Redden. So this is the daughter that we saved. If you're looking for wares, speak to my father. Okay.
See anything you like.
Wow. I see you're a vendor of scepters. Okay. Oh, you've got some shields as well. And some belts. Do you have any belts that I would want? Sadly not. Nothing really's calling out to me here. The crafting supplies might come in handy at some point, but I'm not worrying about crafting until later on in the game. Let's sell these. Get hold of that. We'll get rid of that. So, yeah, for now I'm keeping hold of blue items just so that I, just in case I need them for something, or for other characters or something. Anyway, let us see if we can find somewhere where we can drop off our gear. There's a couple of vendors up there. Well, I've got some reading to do. Oh, that's the bounty table. Okay, I can come back to that later. Captain Sommer.
I hear you dragged all of them sorry ass out of Deadman's Gulch. Good work. Come see me later. Perhaps we can put your skills to some use.
I take it you don't like Ulgrim. Let's just say Ulgrim and the Black Legion have a history. Okay. Hideo Kaltima is too powerful for this world. He is a 500 character at least. So powerful he deserves his own clan. preferably on some remote island like Cuba, so castles in Japan do not suddenly switch allegiances because of the overwhelming strength of his aura. Even then, you'll have 3 to 5 years of calm before he reaches you. It will take him so long because he will go on foot, conquering everything in his way. His way is the rest of the world. Oh dear. Yeah. So, yeah, funny thing about that, I've been doing a little bit of testing for so far with the Nobunaga's Ambition playthrough. We may not be going, we may not be starting in Ishiki. I do intend to be in that general vicinity when we start, though Ishiki might not be the starting point we're looking for. Reason being is my fears were true and then some when it comes to the Miyoshi clan. Honk. Yeah. The Miyoshi clan give you about 1 year before they attack you. Also, they start the game off with a scornful disposition towards you, which means you can't sort of win them over in the space of a year with diplomacy. It would require a really, really lucky start with being able to access treasures and having the money to purchase treasures and then offering them to someone in the Miyoshi clan to sort of ease things over with them and get a bit of a boost in reputation with them. So, yeah, I may have to try a different tack with that. My current idea with starting that is to go slightly further down the island a bit and then maybe butter up the Chosokabe, as they are also a smallish clan, but historically they are a little more significant. Oh, yep, posture check, thank you, Tor. Yep, I'm definitely having fun. Just not long got back from a break, and now I'm talking about a completely different game. Anyway, Inquisitor Creed's lectern. There we go. There's the 8th entry to his journal. Right, before we go on to the journal entries, let's go to the Black Legion scouting report. Oh, by the way, Kuchishima is the name of an endangered cow breed. I had a feeling it was going to be cow related, Maxis. I didn't say anything because I hadn't been able to confirm it, but yeah, that was my suspicion. Also, hello, Mr. Hickory Dude. Good to see you. Let us give you a shout out. I don't need to pause the game. And also, oh crikey, what's going on with my chat overlay? Raiders, hello. Let us give. Well, I'm giving you a shout out eventually, Hickory. But first of all, Kisai Tenshi, hello. Hello indeed, and I will give you the shout out first, seeing as you are the raider. I hadn't noticed. Unfortunately, I've got my speakers down low because of my current audio setup. I don't want to get the game caught up on my microphone, and I'm not wearing headphones, due to hearing condition that flares up from time to time. But yes, how did your stream go? And thank you, welcome. I hope you enjoy the stay of me sort of rambling about everything and not playing grim dawn right now. But yeah, I will give you a shout out in a bit, Mr. Hickory Dude. And the reason why is because I know you do stream from time to time. So that means I will shout you out if I notice you. Otama 9. Now, which one of those is the one that Spoonie made fun of the most? I know he was a big fan of the Otama games, but there was one that he did not like in particular, and I think it was Otama 9. Right. Yes, unfortunately, I don't know all that much about the Otama Onlines. Other than the fact that they are very classic RPGs. Betrayal! Betrayed me! Oh dear, poor XCOM. Actually, no, not poor XCOM. It as clownish as that incident was, Spoonie did have a point. I had a redeem for that on the stream. Good. Good. We should always have that sound clip as a redeem for an Ultima stream. So, I hope it went well. I hope Ultima 9 didn't treat you too badly. Anyway, oh yeah, of course the neighbours start kicking up a fuss. Sorry about this, guys, but you know how it is. Right, time to do a bit of reading. Lots of crashes. Oh dear. So it didn't treat you well. Oh well. It is an old game, and it is one of those old 3D games, if I remember correctly. Yeah. That sort of era, when they started transitioning into 3D for RPGs, it's really tumultuous time for stability. That event was so blistered thumbs. That guy with the glasses game. Yeah. Couldn't get any press access. Ooh. I mean, I knew it was bad, but I didn't realise that that it restricted press access. Oh, that's pretty dumb, to be fair. That, yeah. I mean, as I say, as clownish as that incident was, it's not worth restricting press access because Spoonie had an outburst. And I often think that if it wasn't for Spoonie doing that, I don't think that, you know, I think he opened the way to more criticism of video games being taken seriously by developers. I think that incident sort of lined up Total Biscuit and his success and his ability to critique games in a rather vocal manner. So yeah, as much stick as I will give Spoonie these days, I think that event was overblown, definitely. And lots of the early PC 3D stuff wasn't the most stick. Yeah. That's very true, says the person that enjoys Morrowind. quite a lot. I said I'd do the shout out, and there you go. So, if you don't already, go give Mr. Hickory Dude a follow. When he does stream. He seems to stream at times I'm unavailable to sort of watch for any appreciable length of time, unfortunately. So, if you're looking for a stream while I'm not streaming, then, well, there you go. Mr. Hickory Dude may have you covered. Anyway, let's get on with reciting some lore, shall we? So, the Black Legion Scouting Report. I wrote this letter to report of extreme and disturbing ethereal activity to the north of Homestead. I set off to the foothills and made my way through the warren of low stone walls, fences and occasional farmhouses. I was careful to move in secret and remain undetected from the horrors that still roam the fields unchecked. I made it to the valley of two hills, near the river, when I witnessed something I can barely comprehend. An unearthly black pillar that was neither stone nor flesh drifting slowly across the land, as would a low cloud. A sickly green glow burned at its core, and great writhing tendrils hung from somewhere underneath the shifting black shell. I watched in mounting dread as the unholy obelisk slowed and then, without warning, burrowed the hooks of dangling tentacles into the ground. The ground began to wither and glow with the same unwholesome green. It was then that the obelisk pulled itself into the ground with a sound that made me feel as if the earth was dying. It began glowing so bright I could hardly look. Its power seeped into the ground, twisting and corrupting as it spread. I lingered for nearly an hour in place, and in that time, a great distance around the obelisk had been changed. I was about to leave when the obelisk erupted from the ground and drifted to an untouched patch of the land to begin the cycle again. We must act soon, or there will be nothing left to save. 6th Regimental Scouts of the Black Legion. Renal Obrak. Huh. Okay, that doesn't sound too good, does it? We got two more reports. The 7th entry of Inquisitor Creed's journal. Much time has passed since my last entry. Following my escape from Krieg's laboratory, I've raced against time and lost. Passed through darkness and flame. Sorry. Something was catching my throat just then. Sorry, I'll try that again. I've raced against time and lost, passed through darkness and flame, and witnessed the ruin of the world as I knew it. Even as I assumed key figures in the capital were likely to be possessed by entities we now call ethereals, I reasoned that it was only with support from within the capital that we could hope to thwart them. Any action that began outside the capital could be spun as political rebellion and crushed with the Empire's own forces. Before the truth could be exposed. Thus, I cast the dice and raced towards the heart of Arulan, trying to conceal myself the best I could. Upon my arrival, I proceeded cautiously, booking a room at a squalid inn near the west gates in an effort to keep my appearance, my arrival secret. Initially, I sought out old acquaintances, assuming that I could detect some change in personality or behaviour. It might reveal possession. A few awkward reunions made it painfully obvious that years on the road carrying out my duties as an inquisitor have left me out of touch and unable to discern whether any changes were the result of possession or just the passage of time and faded memories. The only gamble left then was to report back to the citadel of the Luminari and see what came of it. I never made it there. Waiting until the sunlight dwindled and crowds thinned in the streets below, I rose to leave, but was quite startled to see that a shadowy figure had somehow silently breached my room, evading all the wards I set against intruders. This is how I came into cooperation with the First Blade. Oh dear. Right, so now that's the second mention of the First Blade. We found out that Ulgrim, the cook that we found, or supposedly a cook that we found, is actually a member of the First Blade. It was known that anyone of significance who fomented discontent or posed a real threat to the rule of the Emperor might be visited by the First Blade. I had never stirred such controversy, but I always imagined if such an encounter took place, I could put up a respectable fight. I never got the chance. Taken unawares, I was disarmed before I even knew what was happening. Had he sought my death, I would not have even witnessed the killing stroke fall. However, he seemed more interested in answers instead, and in turn provided me with an account of his own events that confirmed my worst fears. The First Blade revealed that only days prior he had been forced to turn his knives on the Emperor himself by his own command. Despite the myriad safeguards protecting the Emperor, both mundane and arcane, he had become host to an ethereal. Through the strength of mind, he had usurped his possessor long enough to summon the First Blade, command his own execution, and charge the assassin with ensuring that his son, the young prince, survived to reclaim the throne. His last commands issued, the Emperor's consciousness slipped once again under the control of the ethereal, and a desperate battle ensued. The ethereal blade, the First Blade... Ethereal Blade? That's a different story. The First Blade reported that he believed the Emperor and the ethereal within him slain, but given his inexperience with the entities, could not say anything for certain. He relayed that he had secretly taken the prince and put him into hiding, but declined to elaborate. The First Blade said he intended to retire his imperial title and had chosen the name Ulgrim. Ah! Which made me curious as to whether it was an intentional reference to the mythic character. A final troubling detail was that no proclamation of the Emperor's passing had been issued. Not only did this demonstrate the Ethereals had sufficient control over the palace to conceal the death, but given that they couldn't hope to hide the Emperor's absence for long, it suggested the next phase of their operation was imminent. I strategized with Ulgrim long into the night, formulating a plan to counter the Ethereals, but ultimately we agreed that we could not defeat their conspiracy in time. The only course left was to gather what people and resources we could, go to ground and weather the coming storm, then find a way to counter the invaders. We agreed that the Black Legion would be our best hope in securing allies, and as a conscripted army of criminals, debtors and political dissidents bound to service, it seemed unlikely that the Ethereals would have any reason to infiltrate them when they could control them indirectly through the military high command. The next step was to discreetly make contact. And so we continue with Inquisitor Creed's story. But first... Oh, look! Inquisitor Creed! But we've got Ulgrim to speak with first, so...
I wasn't sure you'd make it, but you pulled through. Those people owe you their lives.
No, I just did what was right.
I wish that was the end of our troubles, but there is a mounting threat on the horizon that threatens to wipe us all out. I'm going to check in with Creed here, but I suggest you speak to Captain Somer. She's the Black Legion officer in charge of this sorry bunch. Look for the grumpy middle-aged hag in Black Legion armor. She'll fill you in on the situation.
Yeah, we've already chatted with her briefly, so yeah, I'll speak with her again. Also, charming. Well, I guess I'll speak with you later. Oh, there's the smuggler. Thank you very much, my beautifully organized second tab. It should cause a few people some upset. Also, while I'm here, there are two traders here. Which I should probably keep an eye out for and check to see if there's anything decent on them, which I don't think there is, but it's a good idea to keep an eye on what they're selling, if not for later. Jewel shield still kills me. Yes. Yes. I do like the totally normal buckler. Oh, and this is the trader for homestead reputation, I guess. Right. The weapons master looks over the supplies and size. Damn shame about the cannons. This place would feel a whole lot safer if we had a few of those beauties mounted up on the walls. What happened to them? We had no choice but to abandon them on the road when the ethereals attacked us in force. Thankfully, the bastards don't know a thing about artillery. What if I recovered them? Then I would call you insane. Treading into that area is nothing short of suicide. There's a reason we call it the conflagration now. It's overrun with ethereals. Even the very ground will cook you alive with ether fire. You like living? Stay out of that place. Just watch me. Okay. Right.
I'll skip the pleasantries. Ogrim tells me you're one tough slip, and right now that's what I need most. Will you fight for the Black Legion?
Where do you need me?
The Legion is split on two fronts. To the north, we have the Cult of Cathan. Nasty bastards keen on turning all of us into a puddle of blood for their rituals. I have my best men out there right now, scouting ahead. The cultists are amassing in great numbers, and I'd like to know why. There is a more pressing issue, however, and this is where you come in. Ogrim says that you are experienced with fighting the Ethereans. That's good. You'll need all your skills for this one. Far to the west, beyond the infested farms and the rotting croplands, there is an area teeming with ethereals that we have started calling the Gruesome Harvest. It is a fitting title as the ethereals have been gathering corpses, animal and human alike, in order to conduct their sick resurrection techniques upon them. The barn there has been giving off a blinding aether light non-stop for the last few days and nights. That is, until today. Whatever they are working on, it must be nearly finished. And knowing the ethereals, it's something monstrous. We can't risk the ethereals discovering that we know about their creation. I need someone to sneak in there and destroy this abomination before it even has a chance to wreak havoc upon my people. We'll only get one shot at this, so I want someone who has experience dealing with ethereal horrors to handle this mission. Will you be my champion?
You say sneak. I don't really do sneaking very well. But what about the Demapterans?
Been talking to Douglas? Look, I'd love to solve all the world's problems, but unfortunately I do not have the troops to send them out on a bug hunt. Douglas and the other farmers will just have to accept it for now. Perhaps later, once the Ethereals and the Cathanians have been dealt with, then I can think about sending some men out to the fields to clear out this infestation. The Legion is split on two fronts.
Yep, okay, fine. Okay. Yeah, it's all about that stealth. Yes. Yeah, the one thing action RPGs are renowned for, it's the stealth segments.